I will go into matter and explain you how we are doing the experiments. I will start in the main topic of the presentation will be talking about transmission measurements, which are the principles, the base principles behind these measurements. I will try to explain you how we determine the background in the facility using black resonance filters, and then I will pass to explain all of this in an example using the American 241 transmission measurements. And then, if I have time, I will enter, started to explain also about reaction cross-section measurements, the principles, and how we calculate the reaction yield. We can jump. So we pass directly to the transmission measurements. Transmission measurements is to measure the total cross-section. So we are, for measuring the total cross-sections, we are not adding all the channels that Jan showed before, but that we are measuring is the other part. No, we are measuring which neutrons are not reacting with the sample. So those that are traversing, and that is what we call transmission, no? The fraction of neutron beam traversing the sample without interact with the with it. So this is in opposition with the reaction yield. That reaction yield is the fraction of the neutrons that are interacting in a certain way with the sample. In this case, that shown here is a capture experiment. No, you detect the gammas that are reacting in the sample. So you see here, you detect neutrons that are not interacting, while here you are detecting the products of the reaction. So it's completely different approach. The first interesting point of this approach is that in the transmission experiment, the theoretical transmission is directly related with the total cross section, no? By this formula, while in a reaction cross section, the reaction yield is not directly related with the reaction cross section, but also at least you need the total cross section to measure. So this is the first advantage of the transmission experiment. The second one is that we measure the experimental transmission performing the following experiment. The first, we measure the neutron beam without any matter on it, and then without the sample in the beam, and then we put the sample and we measure how many neutrons are still reaching the detector. Doing this simple ratio, we already get the experimental transmission. And the main advantage of doing this ratio is that we don't care about the neutron flux, we don't care about the detection efficiency, because both are canceling the ratio. And then, like this, that means that if we are fulfilling certain conditions, we have directly the total cross-section obtained from the experimental transmission. So, and this is possible to do when we have what we call good transmission geometry, which are the following conditions. First, we have to require that the neutrons that all the neutrons that reach the detector pass through the sample. Then, the second, that if a neutron is scattered in the target, it doesn't reach the detector. And the third is that we have to collimate the beam to have a parallel neutron beam, and the sample should be perpendicular. And this we can get it with going to long distance and with a special geometry. And this is what we call good transmission geometry. You know? It's, everything is done by collimation. You know, it's the most important part of a transmission measurement is the collimation. This is very fast. Okay. This is how it looks schematically, the flight path in a transmission experiment at Geelina 50 meters. We have here the neutron source, the Cronwet wall in the, that separates the bunker from the flight path, the first part of the flight path with the collimator here in black. Then a half path of the flight path is the sample with some filters that I will explain later. And then at 50 meters, we put our neutron detector. In this case, the lithium glass detector that already Jan explained in his presentation. So, but there is a fourth condition that we have to fulfill to get very nice cross sections in transmission. That is that the sample should be homogeneous. That means that it has the same thickness everywhere in the sample. We have the same thickness everywhere in the sample. If we fulfill that, we can get very precise, very accurate cross sections. So, these are some pictures of the experimental setup, no? The flight path that I showed schematically before. Here I show the what we call the sample station at 25 meters. So you can see here the sample and some filters, the sulfur filter and other filters that are here. And you see that we put them in some kind of tray that we can move remotely, so we can put it in and out of the bin very easy with only programming the engine. And then here I show the lithium glass detector that already Jans presented the schematic view. But of course you don't see it is inside the black plastic bag to avoid the light entering in the detector and causing noise. And this is what you have. I mean, you have only the samples with the filters and the detectors. And with all this, only these two components, with the proper sealant, you can do the measurements. This is the lithium glass detector. You use it for in the region of the resonance and up to hundreds of kV. But you can also perform transmission measurements in the fast energy by using a detector like fast neutron detector, for example, based it in the elastic scattering cross section in hydrogen. So, but the measurements that we perform in galena usually are with lithium glass. This is what I will show. So now I will try to explain you how we determine the background in galena for these transmission measurements. What we use is that we call the black resonance technique. The idea is to put in the bin, next to the sample, we put a material that has a strong absorption of neutrons at a certain energy. So for the time of flying corresponding to this energy, we remove all the neutrons that are coming in the bin to the detector. And put in different filters, for example, I show here the case when we put the sulfur that I showed before, a cobalt filter and a bismuth filter, we have these dips here that are given to you. No, the bottom of the dips provide you know where is the background. No, where is the level of the background? And how it works exactly? This idea is that in principle in a in this in galena, no, it's a white source. You have your beam, neutron beam, with a lot of, with all the neutron energies. So, for example, if we look at the, we have neutrons that are coming at this energy, 132 electron volts. If we put, these neutrons at this energy, at all are they are coming at a certain time that is given by these formulas. If we now put in the beam a material like copper that has a very strong resonance at 132 electron volts, the cobalt will absorb all the neutrons that are coming in the beam with this energy, with 132 electron volts. So in principle, we should not have measurements here related with the beam. But what we will have is the background. No? What is remaining is the background. And this background comes because, for example, from natural radioactivity or contribution, because as Jan explained, we are a multi-user facility, so we have different flight paths that are, you will remember, no? There's like they are exiting from the target call, so we can have neutrons that are scattered in other flight paths and come to our detector. Then, we have, and this is a background that is independent of the time. But then we have also time-dependent backgrounds. The first one is related with the gammas that are coming with the beam. These gammas are not stopped by the cobalt filter. And the main contribution of gammas is coming from the capture of the neutrons in the water, no? In the hydrogen of the water, that produce 2.2 mega electron volt gammas. And it results that these gammas cannot be distinguished from the neutrons with the lithium-6 glass detector, because these high energetic gammas deposit more or less the same energy that the neutrons. So it's a background that we have to take into account. Then the second one is neutrons. It's a background due to neutrons with higher energy, but that don't reach the detector directly, but only reach the detector after scattering on the pipes or in the material. So after scattering, they reach the detector at it results that because they have higher energy, but also higher, longer flight paths, they reach the detector at the same time that corresponds to the neutron to the 132 electron volts. So this also will contribute to the background in the deep. And then the last one is that this famous overlap neutrons that Jan started to explain. No, because we are a pulses facility with a high frequency. Usually we work at 800 hertz. That means that between one pulse and the following one, we have a separation of 12.5 milliseconds. You can do the calculation if you want. So that means that all the neutrons in a pulse that arrive to the detector with an energy that implies that arrive to the detector after this 12.5 milliseconds will overlap with the following pulse. So some of them will arrive to the detector at the same time that correspond to the 132 electron volts. So we have to calculate to estimate this background and consider this background. In principle, to avoid this background, we usually use what we call overlap filters, cadmium or boron 10 filters that removes the low energy part of the spectrum. But mainly with the boron, there is always neutrons that are remaining. And this is how it looks. A typical background for a transmission experiment, but decomposing in the different components. You have here the time-independent background, no? The constant background, that, for example, we can determine the background for our experiment if we close the shutter. So in principle, there will be no neutrons coming in the beam, and all the neutrons that are coming for other flight paths and the radioactivity will come. So we can study this background like this. Then we have the gamma background that is contributing mainly at high energies. This background, this is time independent. Also, we can study this background by removing the neutrons from the beam and leaving gammas, and that's we can do it putting the polyethylene in the beam, so we remove the neutrons, so we can study the gammas. Then you can also have scattered neutrons, that is this component here, it's a long skin, and finally the overlap neutrons that are coming here. This also we can study what is the contribution of the overlap neutrons by, for example, changing the frequency of the accelerator. If we change the frequency, for example, at 50 hertz, the next pulse will arrive much later. So we can study, if not, we have to cut here. No, this is corresponding to a cut of 12 of the 12 milliseconds corresponding to the 800 hertz. But if we change the frequency, we can study this and we can see what is the shape. Usually, when we are doing an experiment, we can already taking this tail, we can already extrapolate and estimate the overlap neutrons that we will have in the next beam. So, okay. So this is more or less the technique that we use. The only thing is that this has some price. We have to be very careful when we use this black resonance technique, because anything that you put in the beam, of course, will remove neutrons, but also it removes background. And we will see this, because we will see what happens. For example, here I show you the transmission spectrum that we obtain using a manganese sample, that it presents already itself a black resonance filter. So already with the sample, we can have an idea where is the background. If we now put one germanium filter, we will see that, of course, you get more black resonance, for example, here. But also in the depths of the manganese, you can see that the green is below the blue. That means that germanium filter is also removing some part of the background that is reaching the detector at this point. The situation is even more clear if we put this big sulfur filter. You see here that the difference in the background after putting the filter and without the filter is huge. So we have to be very careful when we put the filters. And to account for these effects, we have two possibilities. That is, to correct it, we can do two things. The first thing that we can do is use different filters with different thickness. Like this, we can extrapolate the background that we would have if there was zero thickness filter. And the other option, and this is also quite simple, is that use fixed filters always in the beam, so we don't care. They are there, the fixed filters are there when we measure with the sample and without the sample. So it's like you don't need to correct for them, because it's already a characteristic of your beam. So I will try to explain a bit better now when doing the real experiment. So this real experiment, no, is a transmission experiment in americium 241. Here, for the transmission, for the americium, this americium, for the region of interest is the resonance region here, no? These are the resonance coming from the americium. And this is the spectrum that we obtain with the americium in, and this is the spectrum that we obtain with the when we remove the americium. For this experiment, the three fixed filters were used: sodium, bismuth, and cobalt, that were there in both cases, no, in sample in and sample out. So in the ratio, they will disappear, the effect. And we can use these filters at high energies, because this region is not of interest for us. No, we are interested in the region, so we can leave it there, and this is not affecting the resonance analysis that we will do. But for example, if we want to use tungsten and silver, this will affect. So what we do is, to get the full shape of the background, is do another measurement, and when we include, apart from the fixed filters, tungsten and silver filters, so in that experiment, we determine the shape. And then when we go to the real experiments, we only need to adjust the background level using these points here and this point here. So that's the idea. So when you have already characterized your background, you subtract it to the spectrum, and you make the ratio, and you obtain the transmission of the sample. And in the case, for example, in this case for the americium, this transmission is as accurate as is at the level of 0.25%. So you can, with this number, you can have an idea the powerful of this method, not to measure cross sections, no, that you can get cross section well below the 1%. When you have already your experimental transmission, what you have to do is to extract the resonance parameters. So we go back to the theory. I recover part of the jam presentation. He already present the refit code. That is the code that we use to extract the resonance parameters for the resonance analysis. What we do is we modulate the transmission that we will have in case, putting the sample characteristic, putting the facility and detector characteristics in the response function that he explained in detail previously. And what we do is less square fit between this model and the experimental transmission that we measure. But this is done by refit, and we can obtain then the resonance parameters. No? The best values are just adjusted to the experimental data. And this is how we obtain the cross-section with a transmission experiment. If we now pass to the reaction cross-section, in the reaction cross-section, I explained before, we have to measure the reaction yield. Now, the situation is a bit more complicated in both senses. No? First, for the reaction, the theoretical reaction yield, you have also to know the total cross-section. That, for example, you can take from the library, so do a dedicated experiment transmission. But but only in the case of a thin sample, you can forget about higher order terms and use this truncate the serial to this part. But in any case, you will have to know also the total cross section and the reaction cross section. Both of them are affecting the reaction yield. And only in the case of you have infinitely thin sample, like it could be the case, for example, for certain fission experiments, that the targets are very, very thin, then in that case you get a direct relation between the yield and the cross-section, but only in this case. In capture experiments, this is not usually the case. Usually you have thick samples, and if you have thick samples, even the self-shielding correction is not enough. You have also to apply multi-scattering correction. What this is multi-scattering correction? What is happening? It's part of this part of the gammas that you detect in your detector are coming from direct reactions, direct capture in the neutron. But for some cases, the capture that you measure is not produced by the neutron directly, but for the neutron after scattering in the sample once, or even more than one time. So, in fact, what you have is that the cross-section, the energy at which the neutron has been captured is not the energy given by the time of flight. It is completely different. The relation between N and N' is given by this formula. I don't know why it's not. I think it's losing power. So the relation between the energy between the neutron and the scattering neutron is given by this relation. So you see that is depending on the angle and in the atom. And this implies that you have, instead of having a clear resonance, if you have a thick sample, you will have things like this in your yield. How is it possible to explain this? This is the case of the 56 iron resonance at 1.15 kV. You see here that the big resonance is coming from the direct capture of the neutron. But then, if you have a scattering and then a capture, you will have a contribution, that is the blue curve. And even if you have more scattering, you will have even a longer tail. And these shapes are coming from the following expressions, no? That I showed you before. The peak, the blue peak, is coming because for the possibility of having a scattering and then a capture in the target, there is a direction that is privileged, that is the perpendicular direction, because this is a pancake, like a pancake sample. No, the diameter of the sample is always much bigger than the thickness of the the sample. So that explains this peak in the blue curve. No, it's corresponding to the this energy. No, to the energy of the. No, this is not helping me. Yeah, so the peak is corresponding to the energy when you put in the formula 90 degrees, and then this shoulder is corresponding to the maximum energy that the neutron can give to the nucleus, and then there's the last shoulder is a combination between the peak and the and the shoulder. And then also this is for the theoretical reaction Geel, but also for the experimental reaction Geel is also much more complicated to determine that the transmission, because for the reaction Geel you have to determine not only the counting rates but all of these parameters that are the neutron flux. Have to characterize determine your neutron flux, the efficiency of your detector, the solid angle that you cover, so you have to do all the Carroll calculations. Also, you have to calculate the probability that the gamma escape, because this is a probability that the gamma remains in the, not exit from the target when it's thick, and then is the effective area or the interception area, no, is the percentage of the beam that is intersecting with your sample. And when you have all, you have to calculate all of this. This has uncertainties, and it's so that explains, because with a reaction in a reaction cross section, it's much more difficult to get an accurate cross section than with a transmission. And that's all from my part. I will only finish with making publicity. No, for example, the transmission. To show now how the powerful of the method, I will show here now that for with a transmission measurement in gold, at thermal energies you can obtain 0.1 bart in a well below the level of 0.1%, if I'm not wrong. 0.1%. When we with the reaction here, we are talking about few percent. That's all. Peter will continue later, explain a bit more about how to calculate the flux. So no, it's not. I will be in the on Friday. So on Friday, Mr. Kim will explain how to calculate flux and all of these parameters. That's all. If you have any question, I think we have something like 1 minute.